Welcome. And again, thanks for your time. I just wanted to do a brief introduction just while we're getting set up here.
Okay.
We are lucky to be speaking to Dr. David Yermack, who works at NYU. He is a world recognized expert in cryptocurrency, and that's why we have him here today. He is a professor in finance and business at NYU. He also serves as the chairman of finance department, as well as the director of the NYU Center for Law and Business. He teaches joint MBA and law school courses on Bitcoin and cryptocurrency. His primary research areas include boards of directors, executive compensation, and corporate finance. Professor Yermack has published more than 25 articles in leading academic journals covering finance, accounting, economics, and law. He is a faculty associate of the National Bureau of Economic Research. He has also served as a scholar for the U.S. Federal Reserve Bank. Professor Yermack is crimson through and through. Looking over his CV, he received his BA, his MA, his MBA, JD, and PhD, all from Harvard. I'm not sure how NYU drew you away from Boston, but obviously that was a big move for you. And here today to discuss cryptocurrency, which is a very hot topic, and being a world expert, really want to get into whether or not this is the future or whether or not this is a fad. And so again, thanks so much for joining us, Dr. Yermack.
You're very welcome. And just to be clear, NYU is number one in finance. It's a better place to be. So that's, it was easy to recruit me.
All right. So that was a move up, you're saying?
Absolutely. There's only one direction to go from NYU if you're leaving the finance department, which is to a slightly lower ranked institution.
I guess the question is, are you a Yankees or are you a Red Sox fan?
Oh, very much a Yankees fan. I grew up in New Jersey cheering for the Yankees. So I, in a sense, was moving back home when I came back to NYU.
All right. Great to hear. It was a tough loss, though, against the Red Sox the other day.
Unbelievable. And I saw that Bucky Dent was at the game. And
yeah,
I thought that would be all that was necessary to ensure the win.
Yeah, I was rooting for them, but it obviously did not work out that way. So I guess let's just start kind of with the basics, because many people don't really understand the fundamentals, and that includes me. What exactly is cryptocurrency? People think of currency as something tangible. You have a coin, you have a dollar bill. What exactly is cryptocurrency?
Yeah, I think it's important to realize that for a long time now, most of your money has been electronic, that you would pay for stuff with credit cards, with Venmo, and you know many other platforms, and never give it a second thought. Most people really don't use physical cash much for anything anymore. But what's different about Bitcoin and cryptocurrency is that it's not issued by a political authority like the Federal Reserve Bank. It's issued by a computer network. And not only is there a computer network, but nobody's in charge of it. It's an autonomous network. It's running on about 10,000 nodes in the cloud all over the world. And it's simply governed by the software that was started a little over 12 years ago and has run pretty much more or less interrupted since that time with its own rules for creating money and resolving disputes. So rather than putting your trust in a political institution, you're putting your trust in software, cryptography, and mathematics.
I mean, who's recording these transactions? Who is there a governing body? Is someone looking over this to make sure that there's not illegal activities?
Everybody shares the work. The 10,000 nodes on the network actually compete with each other. This is a process called mining, where every 10 minutes, there's a new block of data added to the ledger, which is known as the blockchain. But what's very important is that everybody has an up-to-date copy. So the job of the auditor is really crowdsourced to everybody on the network. And if somebody tries to cheat or change the ledger, everyone will see that happening in real time. And the penalty for someone trying to do that is they just get ignored by everybody. You know, anyone can break in and try to change the ledger, but people just won't pay any attention. They know what the true copy is and they'll continue to work off of that. It's very different than the way a bank works, where there's one ledger and there's an auditor who comes four times a year and make sure that the balance sheet still balances. You know, we've used double entry bookkeeping for about 700 years, but what you really have with this blockchain ledger is a radical breakthrough in accounting. You know, that's the real innovation here is an accounting innovation, And these don't come very often. In fact, you know, this really is the biggest thing since the Renaissance in financial record keeping.
Now, people, so you mentioned blockchain, and a lot of people don't know the difference between blockchain and the actual cryptocurrency. How does the blockchain work exactly, and how is it different than the actual cryptocurrency?
A blockchain is a database, and what is special about it is that each entry is connected to the previous entry by a series of codes. So if somebody were to try to change an entry in the ledger, which is what we usually call fraud or theft or hacking, you would change not only the entry that you cared about, but every subsequent entry, which because they're chained in sequence, and it would be immediately obvious not only that somebody had changed the ledger, but where the change had occurred. So this provides a degree of transparency and security that you just don't get from regular financial records. The blockchain could hold any kind of data that you really wish. And one thing that you can put on it is financial records, such as the balances in the wallets of Bitcoin. But you could also have ownership of stocks and bonds. And you can put healthcare data or real estate data or, you know, any number of other things where you care about the data being secure and not vulnerable to somebody breaking in and changing it. So, you know, it's really a type of database that potentially can be important in any industry where the security of the data is important to the people in the industry.
Now, there's obviously dozens and actually hundreds of cryptocurrencies.
Thousands, actually.
It's kind of crazy how it's just exploded. What would you say are the top five or six cryptocurrencies currently?
Well, there's no dispute that the top two would be Bitcoin and Ether. Bitcoin was, of course, the first, and we're coming up later in October on what will be the 13th anniversary of the posting of the famous Bitcoin white paper that kind of announced it to the world. And I think today Bitcoin is about 40% of the entire market. If you look at the value of all the Bitcoins compared to all the crypto, is worth about $2.25 trillion. And Bitcoin just by itself is close to $1 trillion. So Bitcoin is far and away the largest. And then no question that the second largest is the Ether token that resides on the Ethereum blockchain. But these are really quite different. Bitcoin is really just meant to be a payment system, not unlike the US dollar, where you could go shopping with it and, you know, use it to keep pocket money and so forth. Ether is for paying the fees to activate smart contracts, which is a much more elaborate form of, I think it's similar to insurance and risk management is maybe the best way to think about it. And it's come to be known as decentralized finance, where you can engage in things like borrowing and lending and insuring things. All of those transactions have to be activated by paying fees on the blockchain, and Ether is the token that you use to pay those fees. So the Ethereum is about, at this point, half as valuable as Bitcoin, maybe $400 billion in value. I think in the long run, it wouldn't be surprising if the Ether value overtook Bitcoin, but that's still a number of years away. And then going down the list, I think probably the third biggest would be Tether. Tether is what's called a stable coin. One Tether should equal one US dollar. And so it's very convenient as a medium of transacting because people still like to refer to the unit of account being money from the real world, from the United States mostly. And then the rankings of the others begin to move around, but what's been valuable very lately is another blockchain token called Cardano. And there's a coin called Dogecoin that's closely associated with meme finance and Elon Musk. And then you would add in others like Litecoin has always been big. And, you know, there's in the range of 5 to 20, the value of them tends to rearrange rather quickly. But I think at this point, 70 or 80 cryptos are worth at least $1 billion.
Wow. I mean, can anyone start a cryptocurrency? Oh, yeah. And I'm assuming many of these can fail. How does a cryptocurrency fail? No one backs it up and it just...
Yeah, no one uses it. People are indifferent to it. So in fact, I have a colleague who teaches a class and all of the students create their own coin in the first week of the class. And then they try to, you know, market it and, you know, they go through all the steps, but it's really not difficult that you and I, even during this interview, could launch our own coin. But the trick is getting people to adopt it, which is much, much harder. And that requires a degree of marketing. Ideally, the coin will meet some business use that, you know, will cause people to want to have it. And, you know, many of the very successful tokens and coin offerings and so forth have been connected to some type of startup business where the token is somehow internally important to the operation of the business. So, you know, many ways to market these, but ultimately, if they're not meeting somebody's business need, they're probably not going to be widely adopted.
Have you ever had a student start a coin that takes off?
Not that I'm aware of, although I have to say I have a colleague at Duke University who has had some very successful entrepreneurs that were students there and are now donating back to Duke small pieces of the profits from some of these businesses. And I think given the size of our program at NYU, it's probably a matter of time before we do get some alumni who are, you know, deeply involved in the industry and are in a position to support the next generation of students in the same way.
That would be great, obviously. So, you know, speaking about how it's decentralized, like you were saying, there's no kind of governing body. Does that make cryptocurrency more at risk for illicit, illegal activities? People have often commented that because it's so difficult to trace, that it could be involved in criminal transactions. Do you feel like that's a real threat?
Well, there's really two issues here. Governance and traceability are not the same thing. And because the blockchain is widely shared with everybody, it's actually easy to trace. I think people are often overconfident that if you buy drugs with Bitcoin, that no one will know that you did it. In fact, it's the other way around. This is, if you're going to go out and do something stupid, you know, break the law, smuggle, traffic in antiquities, buy drugs or whatever, probably the dumbest way to do it would be on a blockchain because you leave footprints that are visible to everybody forever. And there are forensics companies that make very good livings helping the government hunt these people down. But it is true that there's no leadership, which makes enforcement very difficult. That if you were running, you know, some type of drug dealing operation out of an account at Wells Fargo, they could just go to Wells Fargo and ask them to freeze your account. And, you know, the leadership of the bank is pretty much compelled to cooperate with the government in these kinds of efforts. And tax collection also relies on the cooperation of banks and intermediaries. But there's nobody to rope into that kind of work. The government can't really regulate the nodes at the center of this thing, which makes regulation extremely challenging. You really have to regulate the customers directly, which is a much more complex and cumbersome task. And I think that there's all kinds of areas like money laundering where it may be easy enough to spot what's going on, but to actually get people to behave better may be quite difficult in the future. And you have to appreciate that the people who started this were libertarians who believe that government should have a much smaller role in surveillance. There should be more privacy and so forth. And they designed this very deliberately to make it hard to regulate. And it is.
Now, are the limited rules and the limited regulations the same in all 50 states? Or does every state have its own cryptocurrency rules and regulations?
You're in a real period of flux. And the United States is a very confusing jurisdiction because we have overlapping state and federal regulation of a lot of economic activity. So there's federal securities laws at the SEC, but there's also state securities laws that are typically enforced by state attorneys general and so forth. Most other countries have just one unified legal system, and ours is much more diverse and complicated because of federalism. But what you're seeing at the state level is a period of innovation where a couple of states have really been very ambitious and have written far-reaching codes. Other states, really the majority, still trying to figure this out and mostly ignoring it. But there will inevitably be questions about when federal regulations eventually come into effect, and I think they will, whether these coexist with or are superior to state law. And this is an old theme in American law, sorting out what we call conflict of laws, where there's overlapping jurisdiction. And the benefits of this is that you get experimentation and the ability for the best practices to bubble to the surface. But I think for the foreseeable future, there's going to be considerable confusion. You have New York on the one hand with extremely restrictive regulation of crypto, and probably at the other extreme would be Wyoming. which has tried to open its doors and make itself the Delaware of crypto, if you can borrow an analogy from corporate law. But I think it's going to change inevitably because states are beginning to grapple with very simple questions of taxation and inheritance. You know, if you die, who gets your Bitcoin and so forth? And, you know, can it be probated in court? All of these laws have to be worked out. You know, the very mundane, but nevertheless, very important details of how to treat this as a form of property, very much a work in progress.
Yeah, and it sounds like, just like you said, it's going to be a lot more clear in the next decade or so. But right now, it's certainly in a state of flux as people are getting more comfortable with this as a mainstream currency.
And I have to say, when we started the course at the university and we offered it to both law students and MBAs, we wanted to graduate the students who would do the work of writing these laws. You know, we saw that we could be agenda setters and put students out there to work on what looked like an exciting new area. And there's no question that that has come to pass, that, you know, there's just a lot of really interesting regulatory questions that are not particularly political, but implicate a new type of property, you know, cryptographically secured property that can't just be treated the way that we've always treated security or currency or other type of law.
So let's go back to basics. Yep. Just for those people who don't totally understand it, let's say John Smith wants to buy cryptocurrency. How does someone buy cryptocurrency?
You have a lot of options. And I think the simplest way is to find a brokerage that would sell it to you and you would just register, not terribly different than getting an account at E-Trade or Robinhood. So in the US, the biggest such broker is Coinbase. And I don't think they would necessarily describe themselves as a brokerage, but they look and act a lot like a brokerage in the stock market. So you can approach essentially an expert third party and buy on accounts with them different coins. But there's also ATMs that if you just walk around in big cities, you'll bump into Bitcoin ATMs and you could use your credit card to get some Bitcoin that way. You can go online and there's various meetups and messaging boards where communities of people trade them back and forth. You can even try to mine them yourself, which is competitive, but you can acquire crypto by earning it, by doing the work of a miner. You can even ask your employer to pay your salary in Bitcoin. And I think there's a couple of pro athletes that actually have this now in their contracts. And there's no reason that if both sides agree that you couldn't essentially collect your wage in crypto.
So how does the mining work? Like, let's just say John Smith wants to mine for crypto. For most people, they don't understand what that concept is. Can you just briefly go over what that means?
Yeah, the process of mining is how the blockchain gets extended with new blocks of data and new transactions being added to the ledger. And the rules of mining were basically fixed when this was launched in 2009. So every 10 minutes, people try to solve a pretty simple cryptographic puzzle. It's a simple puzzle, but it's extraordinarily difficult. The odds are similar to the Powerball lottery, where you basically guess a lot of random numbers and hope that your guess fits into the puzzle and unlocks the block. So if you happen to guess the right number and solve the block, there's a reward, which is currently 6.25 Bitcoin. And they're trading for about 50,000 each today when we're doing this interview. So it's a reward north of $300,000 that's paid every 10 minutes to whomever solves this puzzle. Now, the people who will be good at this are people with very fast computers who can guess random numbers really quickly and try trial and error solutions to these little puzzles. And what you really have are big complexes that have thousands of computers doing this in sequence and, you know, greatly coordinated and upgrading the software or upgrading the hardware as it improves and so forth. But it's become a big industry in its own right. And every 10 minutes, somewhere in the world, somebody is winning this bounty for updating the ledger.
Wow.
And it's sometimes called competitive bookkeeping. It's like a race between accountants to see who can audit the books the quickest is a good way to think about it.
That sounds like I should quit my day job and start mining.
My 13-year-old daughter started mining on her own initiative, and I had nothing to do with it. She's just kind of a sciencey kid. She's 17 now, but 4 years ago, she said, yeah, I was mining Bitcoin last night. And I was very proud, but I tell this to my students because it really shows how easy it is. she didn't have much of a chance. She's using a little laptop, and you really need, at this point, specially designed hardware. You need to worry about cooling it and getting cheap electricity and so forth. But it's essentially done in data centers that are not that different from the data centers that the regular banks use to update their books.
Now, what about wallets? People talk about cold wallets, hot wallets. What is a crypto wallet and what are the different types?
The wallet is where your coins are stored. And every wallet has an address called the public key, which you want everyone to know the address of your wallet because that's the only way that you can receive money. So people in other countries would recognize the IBAN address that is typical in a global bank account in most countries other than the US. To unlock the wallet, you need something called the private key, which is sort of like a password. Only the user knows the private key. And that's the only way that you can spend your coins or send them to somebody else, is to unlock the wallet. Now, what hackers will do is try to steal your private key. And you shouldn't leave this sitting around on your hard drive. You should guard it very carefully. But what a cold wallet is a wallet that's actually detached from the internet. So you could put it on something like a USB drive and then just unplug it so that it's impossible for hackers physically to reach it. So if you're going to hang on to your crypto for a period of time, people sometimes put it into cold storage, as it's called, which means just putting it into a wallet that is disconnected from the internet. And you then have questions about how do you take care of your wallet? You know, do you lock it in a bank vault, in which case you're trusting the bank not to get robbed? You know, there's all kinds of interesting questions about where the security comes from. But fundamentally, it's a lot like the wallet that you would put dollar bills into and carry in the back pocket of your jeans, except it's all electronic.
Now, what about, so recently, just going back to mining, because I had recently heard about China banning mining. Is that something we're going to see here in the US? And what are your thoughts on China banning, crypto mining?
It's very interesting because mining for many years has been, you know, probably 50% Chinese, even higher at times. And the reasons for this are completely bizarre, that many years ago, somebody built a hydroelectric dam in China without permission. And when the dam was finished, the local party boss wouldn't let them connect to the electrical grid. So they had a whole bunch of surplus electricity. And this is really the input to mining, is that you need cheap energy. So the Bitcoin people heard that there was free energy from this remote dam in China. I think it was in Inner Mongolia or somewhere. And they all went there and they never left. Now, the reality is that miners need to minimize cost. And the best place to go is where there's renewable energy, wind power, and geothermal power that you can get for free. So Iceland is often thought of as the optimal mining destination because not only do you get free geothermal, but it's cold there. And so you can cool your machines just by opening the window.
Interesting.
But the miners in China, I think after they sort of lost their cost advantage, they were still probably selling Bitcoin into the local black market to enable capital flight. And I think the reason that the Chinese kicked the miners out back in June is because they knew that they were facing a vast real estate bankruptcy that you might have read about in the press in the last couple of weeks. And I think at the moment, China is vulnerable to a big national bank run, and they are sort of bringing down the gates and trying to keep capital from leaving the country in some type of a panic. So getting rid of the crypto miners was a part of that. Now, where they're going is all over the place, but I think the United States is actually acquiring a much larger market share in the mining market. And a lot of it is in Texas. It turns out there's places in rural Texas where the wind power is abundant and is in many ways ideal for this. And the Texas state government has encouraged miners to come down there with, you know, light regulation and promises not to essentially, you know, square them off of the electrical grid, prevent them from using the local power and so forth. But I think in the long run, really, the miners belong up north. Places like Quebec, Norway, Iceland. You see some in Washington and Oregon, but you need to be north to get the wind power, the hydropower, and the cool air. And I don't think Texas has, at least not the cool air.
Super interesting how all those factors play a role into mining. That's That's kind
it's
of
a very problem. Complicated optimization problem. And you also need access to tech workers who can maintain your machines. Mm-hmm. And you need the latest hardware, which up until now has been manufactured in China. But I think the manufacturer is going to have to find a new location as well.
Well, you see that the reward is what, 600,000 every 10 minutes if you can
300 at the moment, 300? But it goes up and down with the price of Bitcoin.
Yeah, so that would, and you know, speaking about the volatility, that's a concern that many people have in terms of cryptocurrency. What are your thoughts on the volatility?
When I first got into this area, the academic paper that I wrote, and this is 8 years ago, focused exactly on this issue. And I said, this is a pretty poor form of money because the volatility was about 9% per day. That's the standard deviation of daily changes. And I said, you go to bed at night, you want to wake up and know your money is pretty much the same value as it was a few hours ago. And crypto has never provided that. And the volatility today, after almost 13 years of Bitcoin, really hasn't come down that much. It's much riskier than even technology stocks. So I think it's not a great form of money. And what people have tried to do to push back against this is invent these so-called stable coins. And I mentioned before the Tether coin that is supposed to be pegged one for one for the US dollar. Now, the reality is the Tether does go up and down, but it actually has been more stable than you might have expected. But this is, I think, one of the things that has held back the adoption of crypto on a wide scale is that it really is much too volatile compared to regular currencies issued by governments. And it's not been terribly successful at catching on, I think, you know, partly for that reason.
Now, you had mentioned before how cryptocurrencies can be upgraded. So for example, Ether is going to go to 2.0 pretty soon. How do these upgrades affect the holder's value? And what can they expect as these currencies continually get upgraded?
It's very interesting because it's a form of bottom-up governance that you or I could go home tonight and propose a change to Bitcoin, which has been pretty much undisturbed for 13 years. And if we could convince the 10,000 nodes that were out there one by one to adopt our version of Bitcoin, that's where the upgrade occurs. So it, you know, really relies on a process that we call consensus, where you get a clear majority of the people to agree to a change in the rules. So Ethereum is going through such a thing right now, and there's been a lot of beta tests and staging of the upgrades, and it's been on the drawing board actually for several years, but they are changing the form of mining, and they're also trying to accommodate growth on the blockchain. One of the big problems with Bitcoin is it essentially has volume constraints. It can only handle 4 transactions per second worldwide. But Ether is trying to scale up and has a team of developers, and the involvement of the original founder of Ethereum is still very much day to day. So there is at least some unofficial leadership there. But ultimately, you have to convince people from the bottom up to upgrade. And if people hold out and refuse to go along, you can have a division in the community, which is what we call a fork. A fork is where you either take the branch with the new software or you stay on the old path, and you do get coins that fork, where you've got two rival versions, both pretending to be the true version. And Ethereum itself underwent a fork back in, I think it was 5 years ago, which still has not been resolved and maybe never will be.
You know, speaking about recent inflation with all of this stimulus money, which has been printed, do you feel like cryptocurrency is a safe investment in this environment?
A lot of people are attributing the run-up in crypto, you know, roughly over the last year and a half, to the COVID interventions by the central banks. And I think, you know, there's clear reasons to be concerned about inflation and monetary policy. People have different points of view about this. But if I were looking for the safe haven, I'm not sure it's crypto. You know, there may be people out there who do believe that crypto protects you against inflation. But as we were just discussing, crypto is very, very volatile. And I think one of the biggest risks of crypto is that the innovation is still very rapid, so that if you're holding, let's just say, Bitcoin today, there's no guarantee that something much better isn't going to show up next year and get people to unload their Bitcoin and essentially upgrade to a better digital coin. And you may remember the browser wars when the World Wide Web was in its first 20 years. You went from Netscape Navigator and Internet Explorer. And, you know, there's been the Mosaic browser, a whole bunch of these things. And they had a half-life of about 18 months. And I think crypto continues to change so rapidly that no one coin is safe from being improved upon and overtaken by a much better innovation. In fact, I think that's almost certainly going to happen to most of them, given the number of smart people working in this area.
How is crypto taxed? That's another major question.
With difficulty. The government here in the US has basically said we're going to tax it with capital gains as though you had invested in shares of stock. So even if you have Bitcoin that you just go shopping with and you'll buy a cup of coffee, you're supposed to compare the price of the Bitcoin when you got it, maybe 6 months ago, with the value at the time that you traded it to Starbucks for a cup of coffee, and you would have a capital gain or a capital loss, which is just incredibly inconvenient. Now, the IRS has had great difficulty making the rules and following the logic of crypto. And one of the really funny things right now is that they define something called a virtual currency. And they say, among other things, a virtual currency is something that is not legal tender in any country. You may know that at the start of September, El Salvador made Bitcoin legal tender. And so now the tax regime of the IRS has been completely undercut. You know, you want to tax virtual currency, that's fine, but Bitcoin doesn't meet your definition, does it? And I think not only is this so decentralized that you really can't collect the tax easily, you know, the way we collect tax in the US is to have merchants withhold it at the cash register or to have your employer withhold it from your paycheck. You can't do this with crypto because it's so decentralized, you can't get the third parties to intervene and make these transactions. But just defining what is taxable, how do you measure the value, what is the timing of your acquisition, all of the very basic parts of a tax regime have been incredibly challenging for the IRS. And I think it's not much easier in any other countries. The reality is that the vast majority of this tax goes uncollected, even though in theory, people should be paying it like you should with any other property that you buy and then see it go up in value.
Now, do you see as Bitcoin, as these cryptocurrencies become mainstream, do you see the price of gold and other metals dropping?
It's an interesting question. And a lot of people like to put Bitcoin and gold side by side. In fact, just today, there's a report out from a JP Morgan analyst saying that there's a switch out of gold and into Bitcoin, especially among younger people. But I'm not sure that we know yet whether these are substitutes or complements. You would expect them to be negatively correlated if one was a substitute for the other, but that's not what the data show. And the positive correlation they exhibit is not particularly strong. The data I looked at earlier this week said that recently the correlation between Bitcoin and gold was about 0.2. And that suggests that they're different, you know, that each plays its own role. Exactly what that role is far from clear. But people, in my opinion, lean on this comparison much too heavily. I think Bitcoin is a very interesting type of investment, but it's not the same as investing in gold. And I'm not sure that it ever will be.
Now, looking at another question about Bitcoin, you know, becoming mainstream and also cryptocurrency, do you see the crypto market eventually becoming like the next stock market on Wall Street as it becomes mainstream?
I think you'll definitely have people owning crypto the way they own stocks for investment purposes. But the architecture and the regulation of the crypto markets is likely to be very different than the way we regulate the stock market. What I actually think is probably going to happen is that shares of stock are going to be reissued as digital tokens. And you're going to see stocks and bonds traded on blockchains that if the New York Stock Exchange doesn't quickly build a blockchain of its own, people will just leave that platform. The legacy markets, in other words, are likely to be recreated in the image of crypto using this more modern ledger and the better security. And shares of stock will probably become digital tokens, but ultimately they represent ownership and cash flows, and they'll have dividends, which are all things that crypto doesn't have. So I think, you know, these will be distinct types of property with different legal rights for the owners and so forth, but both of them will be important in the future.
do you think crypto eventually kills off banks, since it's since it's not? So you think banks are a thing of the past at some point?
Banks, auditors, you know, there's all kinds of things that you just don't need anymore. Clearing houses, and they are very much endangered species. I think the other thing that banks are going to be threatened by is that the governments themselves will begin to issue crypto money, the so-called central bank digital currency. And my guess is that 10 years from now, you and I will both be account holders at the Federal Reserve rather than at Bank of America or Wells Fargo. And we'll deal in some type of digital dollar, crypto dollar. And the need for commercial banks to play this role is just not obvious why they'll still be around 10 years from now.
So last question, Dave, just kind of summarize what you predict as an expert in the field, the next 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, when it comes to cryptocurrency and the role in world finances.
The thing that I think is most important, we actually haven't touched on yet, but I think the people with the comparative advantage in creating digital money are the big social media companies. And you've seen this in China already with Alibaba and Ant Financial and WeChat, where the local financial system essentially was taken over by two social media payment platforms. And the Chinese banking system, you know, is deeply troubled because of this. So look to the West. Why wouldn't Amazon issue its own version of the dollar? You know, Facebook began to trot out this Libra, and I think they made some mistakes. But on the sidelines, you've got Amazon and Google with billions of customers and very good cybersecurity and loyal customer bases. And I think they have many advantages that will enable them to be the creators of money. And this money will go across borders. You know, there's 10 times as many people on Facebook as there are in the United States. So the central banks are going to have their hands full competing with social media companies, who I expect will begin creating their own payment vehicles, their own digital tokens. And how this gets regulated and so forth is going to be a big political food fight, but there's an awful lot at stake here, you know, in terms of who controls the money supply, whether the government can still borrow money on the same terms, or will simply have to collect a dollar of tax for every dollar in the federal budget. These are sort of first order questions in macroeconomics that the technology is going to push onto the front burner very, very quickly. So I think, you know, the real place to be looking is at the big technology companies that have global customer bases and really technology advantages over everybody else. Even people like, you know, Twitter and Netflix and so forth, you can imagine thinking about issuing their own coins that would be very widely used.
Super exciting times. It seems like, you know, what you're basically painting is something that seemed like science fiction just 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And just the picture you're painting is very exciting, obviously unknown, but just very exciting to see how the world is changing and how currency is changing. Listen, Dr. Yermack, thank you so much for your time. I know how busy you are. This has been a great discussion for someone who literally knows nothing about cryptocurrency. I feel like I can, not, you know, now at least hold a conversation. So
all right.
I appreciate everything you've done. Obviously, congrats on all your accomplishments. And again, thanks for your time. Have a wonderful weekend.
Hey, thank you for having me on. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.